right. Papa Squad. We're talking about music again. Think about this. Just think about this for a second, please. What is the absolute, no doubt about it, worst band you could possibly think of? The worst! The answer is Imagine Dragons. But if you would have asked anyone in the early 2000s, they would have definitely said Limp Bizkit. Yeah, we're talking about Limp Bizkit today.
Quite the musical difference from the Beatles, right?
Limp Bizkit's a new metal band, and I can't believe we're about to talk about new metal right now. New metal, while is a genre of metal, isn't really metal, especially in the Bizkit situation.
I kind of like to think that it is, though.
On Wikipedia, they also call them rap rock, or rap metal, which, I mean, I guess is closer to what I could describe them as, but I'll be honest, I think new metal is perfect enough. It's a side genre of metal. It doesn't need to sound exactly like this, or this, or even this. So, let's start by asking the big question. Who the fuck are these dudes? Limp Bizkit derives of bassist Sam Rivers, crazy face-painted guitarist Wes Borland, turntablist DJ Lethal, drummer John Otto, and of course, the one and only Fred Durst, who we'll be getting into a little bit later. They hail straight from Jacksonville, Florida, and they released their first album in 1997 with $3 Bill, y'all, which achieved polarizing reviews. Some critics praised the album for incorporating two genres that haven't really been meshed together before at that time, while most reviewers thought it was dog shit. On the album, the band covers Faith by George Michael? Which, of course, you know, George Michael himself fucking hated. Producer Ross Robinson, who also produced Korn's first two albums and would then go on to also produce Slipknot's first, practically begged them not to put it on the record, but after hearing out their interpretation with a tone-changing, heavy-as-all-hell chorus with aggressive drumming and shredding, cool screaming vocals from Fred, and motherfucking DJ scratching from DJ Lethal! Other highlights from this album include their first track, Pollution, which is apparently about people calling their music trash, and it includes some gnarly fucking screams from Fred and some groovy fills and riffs from the lads. Counterfeit, about other people copying the Bizkit style, includes a sick-ass bass duel during the verses and some cool shit that sounds like an organ? But I'm pretty sure it's just Wes doing some cool shit, whatever. Speaking of Wes, in Stuck, Wes does some clean shit during the verses that sound disorienting, a little weird. Also, John Otto goes into a fucking swing beat? Like, what the fuck? And you wanna know what's the craziest fucking part about all this? I just listed off the first three fucking songs back to back. Also, the band and the album received countless controversy regarding their label Interscope, paying a Portland, Oregon radio station $5,000 to play the aforementioned Counterfeit 50 times, which absolutely worked, but at the expense of their public image. But they didn't give a fuck about that. In fact, that's like the whole thing. Not giving a fuck. The album that they just created with their shit-smeared hands was built with a real pissed-off sound, with some of the foulest of the foul lyrics that Mr. Durst had to offer. They never really took themselves seriously, like, at all, especially in the early days, because none of them really expected to blow up. From day one, the band knew that, even if they wanted to blow up, they needed to do more than just make music. Fred knew that he had to do some crazy fucking shit in order to get the public's attention, because as everyone knows, bad publicity is better than no publicity. Yup! Kind of ironic considering that's how most people blow up these days, so really, Fred set a great example if you think about it. After the success of their George Michael cover and absolutely nothing else, the band was determined to jump right back into the studio and cook up another banger in order to prove that they weren't ripping off Korn. And that they did. Significant Other dropped onto shelves on June 22nd, 1999, to positive reception from critics and fans alike. Produced by Terry Dale, who also produced for Pantera and Soundgarden and Deftones and Snoop Dogg! Fun fact, this is actually the only album I've heard prior to making this video. There are actually some killer highlights in here, including arguably some of their most popular songs, Break Stuff and Nookie, tracks that basically define the nu metal genre as a whole. Such good tracks, let me fucking tell you. Some other highlights include their opener Just Like This, which is about their music, I think? There's some weird-ass turntabling going on throughout the track, and I can get down for shit like that. After a section of a high-pitched Durst saying, Limp Bizkit's in the house, y'all, John does a sick-ass groove. After listening to these two albums, I've come to appreciate John Otto's grooves and beats more and more.
Those crisp ghost notes from his high-tuned poppy snare. Oh, that's beautiful.
There's also Rearranged, which is inspired by Fred's recent breakup with his girlfriend and includes a really cool bass line that overlays the track all throughout. I'm Broke, which was supposed to be on the first album but was booted off for sounding too different? Ugh, this might be the heaviest riff I've heard yet. Ooh-wee! Fred and DJ Lethal also go deeper into a hip-hop sound. Has Fred collaborated with motherfucking Method Man?
They put out a music video with a completely different beat that sounds like dog shit. Like, it's... It's alright. In my opinion, I think it kind of sucks. The music video is fucking awesome, though. You should go check it out. But it's not good. Man, there's just something about that original beat by DJ Premier. It's just so much better.
Fred also recorded a track with Eminem, Turn Me Loose, but was left out of the album because they got into a huge piss baby fight. Both tracks feature no John Otto. What the fuck?
Speaking of Fred... Let's talk about Fred. Man, Fred Durst is quite the divisive fella. After doing a shit ton of research, I've come to the grand conclusion that Fred Durst... Anyways... Fred Durst, in the late 90s, early 2000s, got himself into a lot of trouble. Sometimes this dude would just say the stupidest shit imaginable, just to get a rise out of people. For example, in 1999, upon finding out that Corey Taylor of Slipknot burned issues of Calvin Klein featuring David Silvera of Korn, Fred allegedly called Slipknot's fans fat, ugly kids, though he has denied these comments since. This pissed off Taylor and Slipknot and caused a bunch of hostility between the two, even though they'd go on to share a few festival dates in the early 2000s. Oh yeah, and I'm pretty sure he dated Britney Spears at one point? Wait. No. He worked with her on a couple songs.
That's right. Fred Durst and fucking Britney Spears.
Britney came to Durst in need of musical assistance for her upcoming album in 2003, and he helped write three different tracks for her. Apparently, they only worked for three whole ass days, but rumors started getting wackier when Fred dropped some crazy shit on the official Limp Bizkit website describing Britney, and I quote, "A person that I wouldn't have thought could make me feel this way?" Britney completely fucking denied this, sending Fred into a fit of rage and leaking a track, Just Drop Dead.
Yeah, this kind of fucks, not gonna lie.
Other shenanigans include dropping System of a Down from the 1999 Family Values Tour for befriending an up-and-coming Taproot and letting them join the label that they were on. Fucking Durst shat on Creed singer once at his show, leading to him challenging Fred to a fucking fight. Whatever, I'm not gonna sit here and yap on about Fred running around and pissing off everyone on the fucking planet, so let's talk about arguably the band's biggest fuck-up to date, Woodstock. I know damn well if you went up to this dude nowadays and mentioned that show, you'd be getting fucking war flashbacks. Shit was so bad.
Now, once again, I'm not just gonna sit here and explain to you the events of Woodstock 99.
You know, the 30th anniversary festival celebrating the original in 1969, but also ended in flames with women being raped by feces-covered doo-doo men. Look that shit up for yourself. There's a really good fucking documentary on Netflix about it. LIMP BIZKIT were set to perform on the second night after a first night featuring DMX, Insane Clown Posse, and Korn's killer set, which seriously riled up the 220,000 drugged up hippies and bums to an unbelievable degree. Obviously, LIMP BIZKIT on night two failed to help tone things down. About 15 minutes into the set after performing 1999, staff pulled Durst aside and demanded him calm down to see if he was bored. Instead, the band drops into a Ministry cover, Thieves, which riled these sweaty motherfuckers up with those fat riffs. Like, Wes is barely holding on to that fucking guitar, flailing his body all around like that. So, after that, they play Rearranged, which, I mean, has chill verses, but ultimately would come back to a heavy chorus, which is what they did typically anyways. But after that, they finally play Break Stuff. During the breakdown, Fred riled them up even more, to a dangerous level of pissed off.
Time to reach deep down inside, take all that negative energy, all that negative energy, and let that shit out of your fucking system.
Fred, what did you think was gonna— Once it ended, monsters almost immediately began destroying wood structures and buildings near the stage during one of the most aggressive and brutal mosh pits to exist. Dudes started ripping plywood off the giant fence so they could surf on the sea of pit. Horrified of the giant mosh pit before them, several stage technicians assigned to cover the central sound tower placed a sign reading "The Alamo" below the cameras. After the song ended, the broadcast team muted Durst's mic while medical staff took in numerous injured concert goers. After they played Nookie with a spontaneous thought, Fred wanted to crowd surf. Yes, you can watch in the live set video Fred attempting to reach the main sound tower for 6 whole minutes. Quite the marvel to gaze at, I'll tell you. If I were him, I would have definitely done the same thing. That's fucking 220,000 people here for LIMP BIZKIT. Fred must have been going fucking wild. The security team practically begs Fred, with years worth of experience, please, please don't. Probably the scariest thing either of them have seen in their lives. So, you know, after raising up all the naked women, Fred finally signals the rest of the band to end the set with Faith, as he remains on a long wooden board with 4 security guards holding onto him. Or maybe they had another song in mind? Either way, after the song was over, Fred and the band were immediately escorted off of the stage, and that was the end of that. So, what happens next? Well, in 2000, Fred formally announced to the world that their third studio album would be titled Chocolate Starfish and the Hot Dog Flavored Water. The press thought that he was joking. Chocolate Starfish and the Hot Dog Flavored Water dropped on October 17th, 2000. By far, one of the stupidest yet greatest names for an album I've ever seen. And look at this fucking cover! Like, what the fuck even is this? Who are these people? Can you imagine slipping this into your car radio after squinting at the cover and hearing this fucking intro? And then, a drop right in the motherfucking hot dog? Let me fucking tell you about hot dogs. This dude manages to motherfuck 46 times, then drops a bar about it, then says fuck one more time. Like, what? That shit's fucking impressive! And that's coming from someone who said fuck 37 times in the last video. Hot dog, man, that first riff is just mesmerizing. I feel like you could just get lost into it. That breakdown after the chorus too? Even though the track is mainly about, you know, introducing the album and the funk. I think this shows how versatile Wes can be. Speaking of versatile, Donato! My generation opens with a kick-ass drum solo with some cool-ass riffs. That pre-chorus, though, hits. Honestly, all of it hits. Two bangers back-to-back, that's what I like to fucking know. The later section of the song shows some cool tom action with John and some secluded riffs from Wes, building up to a crazy-ass breakdown riff from Wes and... A solo from DJ Lethal! Fellas, this is why LIMP BIZKIT is cool. These fuckheads managed to combine two genres that are complete opposites into something insanely creative and kick-ass. Like I stated before, this demonstrates that in full force. Holy fuck. I'm not really sure what Full Nelson is about, but it's a song alright. Some chugs, but I can't lie, this motherfucker is like tapping his guitar twice for the pre-chorus. My Way? What a classic. What a cool, clean riff. Wes is really killing it with those. DJ Lethal's doing some cool shit with the sample throughout the song, too. And we can't fucking forget about Rolling, Air Raid Vehicle. Notice how three of these tracks all have isolated vocals from Fred introducing each song? That's how you know they're fucking bangers. Oddly enough, this is such a catchy chorus, it's insane. And the verses? You can really tell that the boys really perfected their craft here. And John Otto with those ghost notes and this fucking fell. This one right here? Just insane. Next is Living It Up. Damn! DJ Lethal samples Life in the Fast Lane by Eagles throughout the song. There's a really cool midsection too that features John doing some solo time shit again. This honestly might be one of, if not, the best choruses the band has put out to date. Hell yeah. The One? Who here on YouTube has ever talked about the track, The One? Such an interesting and underrated track. About 2 minutes in, they do a fake fade out? Into something completely different? Well, what the fuck is this? The beat is... dreamy. Psychedelic. Fritz singing, you know, it's alright. Could be better. Fritz not a professional singer, and I'm not really sure what that was, but it surprised me my first listen through, and I thought it was pretty dope. Next up is... Get Your Groove On? The band did a track with Exhibit, and this beat is just fucking insane! Fred and Exhibit are going off hard on this shit. Too fucking bad it's not on Spotify. Unfortunately, the lads use an uncredited sample of music that is played during the aerial trapeze act of Cirque du Soleil Cirque... I'm not even gonna... Instead, on streaming services, you can hear the Dirt Road mix by DJ Premier from earlier, taken from New Old Songs, which is basically a release of, you know, of remixes. This one's okay. I don't know, that first beat just hits like a motherfucker. Next is Take a Look Around. Shows off a cool instrumental section at the start, smoothly transitioning into the first verse. Fuck with it. Then, oh my god, a heavy chorus! Then there's a breakdown using the fucking Mission Impossible motif. You can't make this shit up.
It's weird to think about, but this track was in Mission Impossible 2, which means it's in the same movie as,
It'll Be Okay. Damn. But she said that when my Pontiac died. This clean main riff in particular is just soothing to the ears. There's just something so cool about that tone, too. Really nice sound. This chorus might be the most obnoxious sounding one yet. Wes does some cool shit while John plays around with his cymbals. If you thought this first riff was cool, clearly you haven't heard this one. What? Next up is Boiler, clocking in at 7 minutes. Can you handle 7 minutes of LIMP BIZKIT? I don't even know if I can at this point. Also, what the fuck is this music video? This shit's fucking insane. Like, he's talking to this chick, and then the chick turns into a robot, and he throws a bomb, and this motherfucker jumps out of the
this opening riff and beat combo is like none other that I've heard so far in these dudes' discography. Fred's really getting emotional with this one, for whatever reason. You can hear how frail his voice gets here. What a pre-chorus, too. About 3 minutes in, we're left with two dwelling notes with cool hi-hat shenanigans. Now Fred's screaming, and now he's wailing.
Why? Why?
Then... pure bliss. Fucking beautiful. I feel like they just caught that in the studio on a whim and decided to keep it in. Speaking of, surprise hidden track? After what the last song decided to pull on me?
Ladies and gentlemen, what you're experiencing is, in fact, an interlude. I would like you to kick back and think about everything you've just heard.
Thanks, Fred. This beat's fucking sick. Straight out of Toonami. Finally, we reach Hold On. And this does not sound like Fred Durst. Is it? It's actually not. It's Scott Whelan from Stone Temple Pilots. Harmonizing vocals, too? Like, what the hell? About 3 minutes in, we get a kick-ass guitar solo? But absolutely no John Otto? Actually, there is one more track. A fucking hard-ass remix of Roland with Method Man, Redman, and DMX? This shit is crazy! And yeah, there's also the 9-minute outro. You know, sad through all this. There's actually, I want to say, a 2-minute recording of Ben Stiller laughing at LIMP BIZKIT. Just laughing at the concept of LIMP BIZKIT. That's basically the whole thing. And then there was another hidden track, but what a kick-ass album. These dudes really kicked some serious ass when making this album, and I mean it. There's some great bangers. Some of them becoming what the band is best known for. And Wes leaves the band. Yep. Dude left for a year and a half because he just couldn't take it anymore. Shit got to him bad, I guess. In that time span, the band put out their next studio album. Results may vary.
Almost like they knew it was going to be bad because, in my opinion, I don't think it holds up to the previous three albums.
It's alright. It's a lot more emotional, somber, sober. I'm 12 and this is deep. And while to some that may be a good thing, I came to LIMP BIZKIT for the chill verses with clean riffs, heavy choruses, and aggressive but sometimes toned down breakdowns in that exact order. More singing and less screaming from Fred. Like I said earlier, I don't think Fred is a bad singer, but he's better at dropping bars and screaming his heart out. In my opinion. It shows their maturity, but I'd appreciate more hot dog. I need me some more hot dog. Some highlights include Eat You Alive, a single about fucking Britney Spears. I don't know. It hits. I like the chill section. Of course. They also covered Behind Blue Eyes by The Who, which is, once again, such a random fucking song to cover. And that's pretty solid, too. Everyone fucking hated it, though, because it's fucking LIMP BIZKIT ruining and demolishing an iconic classic track, blah, blah, blah. So, Wes comes back in August 2004, and they hop back into the studio to shit out The Unquestionable Truth, Part 1, in 2005. Apparently now John Otto was absent for a majority of the production for whatever fucking reason, and that automatically loses almost all of my interest.
John Otto is just so cool.
The band also decided to drop with absolutely no promotion or music videos or anything. Completely underground. The album's only 30 minutes long, and when it hits. This shit sounds more like Rage Against the Machine than anything else. The propaganda? Fucks. The truth fucks. Everything else is alright. At least it's not sleeper power ballads. So, after they did that,
The band took a motherfucking 4-year hiatus? They came back with Gold Cobra in 2011, meaning this is the first album with the original lineup since Chocolate Starfish, and it was definitely a return to form. Some underrated bangers on there, like their title track and Shotgun, just to name a few. Then they slept for a few years and dropped a new album 3 years ago. Still sucks. Work began on the album in 2012, but it went through development hell. Just like this video! Dad vibes? Underrated. Out of style? It's alright. Imagine LIMP BIZKIT with a modern sound. Modern clicky drums. I like it, but it's that dog in me that prefers how the drums sound on Significant Other. So, do LIMP BIZKIT really suck? Depends on who you ask. Ever since I joined Ninth and Vine, my musical palette has opened substantially, metal or not. My ears have been exposed to all sorts of random shit, so when it came to hearing LIMP BIZKIT, I usually dug most of what they were laying out. However, to the average music consumer, they probably fucking hate it. They wouldn't understand the concept. Judging from all my research, it probably took a minute for the average listener to get down, but you have to think about this. Everything sounded like LIMP BIZKIT in the early 2000s. That was just the most popular thing at the time. Why do you think bands like Slayer and Metallica put out albums into the genre only for absolutely horrendous sales? You might not need a 3 trillion IQ, but LIMP BIZKIT shows that you can fucking do anything with metal and make it not metal. Fucking no.
Man, how the fuck did LIMP BIZKIT get so popular? Like, I mean, they were just fucking around and doing whatever the fuck they want. I really don't get it, and then they just blew up.
Was it because of that outlandish cover? I mean, no one's just gonna fucking cover Faith by George Michael, right? And just have any motives behind it, like, there's just no fucking way. And like, even then, I mean, I guess, you know, Korn was out around that time, and Korn was pretty popular, so, I mean, I guess that has something to do with it, but surely there's just no fucking way. That just doesn't make any sense. They work from completely different areas, right? Just doesn't make sense.
Oh my god!
What?
What, bro?
A turntablist, guys, come on!
What the fuck even is a turntablist?
You know, like the Ricky, you know, the you know?
Oh, so like a DJ thing.
Not a DJ.
This idea makes no sense, Jack. Where are we even gonna put turntables in one of our songs?
Get Tough or Die, I guess.
That's like the only one.
Just think about how cool it would be if we had a dude with a big-ass turntable on stage with us. Just think about how cool that'd be.
Jack, even if we were gonna put turntables in our songs, it's 2024. A laptop can do anything that turntables can. We could replace our bass player with a laptop.
Shit, you're right.
Can you name a band other than LIMP BIZKIT that utilizes a turntablist?
Jack, that was honestly dumb as fuck. You're fucking out of the band, you dumbass.
A turntablist?
What the fuck?
Now I know y'all be loving this shit right here. LIMP BIZKIT is right here. People in the house, put them hands in the air. Cause if you don't care, then we don't care. See, I ain't giving a fuck. Quit pressing your luck. Untouchable, branded unfuckable. So keep me in this cage until you run that mouth. Then I'ma have to play and break the fuck.